Today we are going to discuss about cardiovascular system. As you've seen in this figure, the heart is divided into four chambers, right atrium, right, left atrium, right ventricle, left ventricle. And in between the ventricles and the atrium, there are walls known as tricuspid wall or mitral wall, mitral on the left side and tricuspid on the right side. And between the vena cava and the right atrium is a pulmonary wall. And between the left atrium and aorta, there is a wall which is known as aortic wall. The heart is a muscular pumping organ located medial to the lungs along the body midline. In the thoracic region, the bottom tip of the heart, known as its apex, the conical shape of the heart on the lower side is known as apex, is turned to the left so that about 2/3 of the heart is located on the body, is left side, with the other 1/3 on the right side. The smaller size of the right is because of the presence of lungs. Because lungs and heart both have to be adjusted on the left side. That's why the left lung has 2 lobes and the right lung has 3 lobes. The top of the heart, known as the heart's base, connects to the greater blood vessels like aorta, vena cava, pulmonary trunk and pulmonary vein. Now we go through the circulatory loop. What is circulatory loop? There are 2 primary circulatory loops in the human body, the pulmonary circulation loop and the systemic circulation loop. Loop means a complete circuit completed with the vessels. Vessels are coming from the heart. The first is pulmonary circulation, transport the oxygenated blood from the right side of the heart to the lungs, means from the right atrium to the lungs, where the blood pick up oxygen and return to left side of the heart. Means after the purification of the blood which they receive from the right heart, that is from the right ventricle, into the lungs, where it takes the carbon dioxide and throw it out with your exhalation, and add oxygen which you inhale into the blood, and then it give it to the left heart, left atrium, left ventricle, and from left ventricle into the aorta and aorta through the whole system. But pulmonary circulation is between the lungs and the heart. The pumping chamber of the heart that support the pulmonary circulation loop are the right atrium, right ventricle. Systematic circulation, this is second one, was one by the pulmonary circulation, carries highly oxygenated blood from the left side of the heart to all of the tissue of the body with exception of the heart and lungs. Systemic circulation removes waste from the body tissues and returns the oxygenated blood to the right side of the heart. The left atrium and left ventricle of the heart are the pumping chamber for the systemic circulation. Blood vessels are the body highway that allow blood to flow quickly and efficiently from the heart to every region of the body and back again. The size of the blood vessels correspond with the amount of the blood that passes through the vessels. All blood vessels contain a hollow area called the lumen, through which the blood is able to flow. Around the lumen is the wall of the vessels, which allow the thin in the case of capillaries, or very thick in the case of the arteries. Blood vessels are lined with a thin layer of the simple squamous epithelium known as endothelium, that keeps blood cells inside of the blood vessels and prevents clot from forming. The endothelium lines the entire circulatory system all the way to the interior of the heart, where it is called endomyocardium. There are three major types of the vessels: arteries, capillaries, and veins. Blood vessels are often named after either the region of the body through which they carry blood or for nearby structure. For example, brachiocephalus artery carries blood into the brachial arm and cephalus head region. One of the branches, the subclavian artery, runs under the clavicle, hence the name subclavian. Sub means under. The subclavian artery runs into the axillary region, where it becomes known as the axillary artery. Arteries and arterioles. Arteries are the blood vessels that carry oxygen from the heart. Blood carried by the arteries is usually highly oxygenated, having just left the lung on its way to the body tissue. The pulmonary trunk and arteries of the pulmonary circulation lobes provide an exception to this rule. These arteries carry deoxygenated blood from the heart to the lungs to be oxygenated. Arteries face high level of the blood pressure as they carry blood being pushed from the heart under great force. To withstand this pressure, the wall of the arteries are thicker, more elastic, and more muscular than those of other vessels. So if you compare arteries and veins, arteries are more flexible. They are thicker and elastic and more muscular. The largest arteries of the body, like aorta, have a high percentage of the elastic tissue that allow them to stretch and accommodate the pressure of the heart. The smaller arteries are more muscular in structure of their wall. The smooth muscles of the arteries, wall of these smaller arteries, contract or expand to regulate the flow of the blood through their lumen. In this way, the body controls how much blood flow to different parts of the body under varying circumstances. Since while you are exercising, jumping, or playing, or doing any physical activity, you need more blood for the performance of the muscles. So, in that way, they control the blood according to the requirement of the blood in that part of the body. The regulation of the blood flow also affects blood pressure, as smaller arteries give blood less area to flow through and therefore increase the pressure of the blood on arterial walls. Arterial are narrower arteries that branch off from the end of arteries and carry blood to capillaries. They face much lower blood pressure than arteries due to their greater number. Decreased blood volume and distance from the direct pressure of the heart. Thus, arterial walls are much thinner than those of the arteries. Arterioles, like arteries, they are able to use smooth muscles to control their aperture and regulate blood flow and blood pressure. Now we talk about the capillaries, which are made up of a single epithelial cell. Capillaries are the smaller and thinnest of the blood vessels in the body and also the most common. They can be found running throughout among every tissue of the body and border the edge of the body, avascular tissues. Capillaries connect to arteries on one end and venules on the other end. Capillaries carry blood very close to the cell of the tissue of the body in order to exchange gases, nutrition, and waste products. These capillaries are present in cells and tissues of the body. The wall of the capillaries consists of only a thin layer of endothelium so that there is the minimum amount of structure possible between the blood and the tissue. The endothelium acts as a filter to keep blood cells inside of the vessels while allowing liquids, dissolved gases and other chemicals to diffuse along their concentration gradient into or out of tissue. Free capillary structures are band of smooth muscles found at the arterioles and of the capillaries. These structures regulate blood flow into the capillary. Since there is a limited supply of the blood and not all tissues have the same energy and oxygen requirement, the pre-capillary sphincters reduce blood flow to inactive tissues and allow free flow into active tissues. Veins and venules. Veins are the large return vessels of the body and act as the blood return counterpart of the arteries. Arteries take the blood from the heart to the body, and veins and venules, they take the blood from the body to the heart and lungs. Because the arteries, arterioles and capillaries absorb most of the force of the heart contract, veins and venules are subjected to very low blood pressure. This lack of pressure allows the wall of the veins to be much thinner, less elastic and less muscular than the wall of the arteries. Veins rely on gravity, inertia and the force of the skeletal muscles contraction to help push blood back to the heart. To facilitate the movement of the blood, some veins contain many one-way walls that prevent blood from falling away from the heart. As skeletal muscles in the body contract, they squeeze nearby vein and push blood through walls closer to the heart. When the muscles relax, the walls trap blood until another contraction pushes the blood closer to the heart. Venules are similar to arterioles as they are small vessels that connect capillaries, but unlike arterioles, venules connect to veins instead of arteries. Venules pick up blood from many capillaries and deposit it into the larger veins for a transport back to the heart. Now we talk about hepatic portal circulation, means a circulation between the body and the liver. The vein of the stomach and intestine perform a unique function. Instead of carrying blood directly into the heart, they carry blood to the liver through the hepatic circulation. When we take the food, when it is digested and reached to the stomach, and from the stomach to the small intestine, duodenum, jejunum, ileum, and from ileum it will change into a liquid form and absorb into the circulation. And this nutrition will go to the liver, and liver will analyze it and find out anything harmful, then it will expel it out through the vomiting and diarrhea. And if it is not, then it is absorbed into the blood and send it to the circulation from the liver, and then it will go to the heart. Blood leaves the digestive organ enriched in nutrition and other chemical absorbed from the food. The liver removes toxins, stores sugar and processes the product of digestion before they reach the other body's tissues. Blood from the liver then returns to the heart through the inferior vena cava. Here is a picture of hepatic circulation. You can see from the abdomen, from the abdominal aorta, the blood will reach to portal hepatic artery, and from hepatic artery it will go to the liver. In the same way, the tributaries from the portion of the stomach, pancreas, and portion of the large intestine. Tributaries from the small intestine and portion of the large intestine, stomach, and pancreas. The deoxygenated blood will go to superior mesenteric vein from pancreas and splenic vein, and from there it will go to hepatic portal vein, and then it will enter into the liver, and then liver will analyze it and give it to the hepatic vein, and hepatic vein to the inferior vena cava, from inferior vena cava to the heart for the purification of blood. You can see over here also there is another picture which is showing return to the heart. Inferior vena cava is bringing blood to the from the liver. It is going to the inferior vena cava, from inferior cava to the heart. Right after meal is lower in glucose than in the hepatic vein. This is a hepatic vein, low oxygen level. Liver a central vein, then there is a erythrocytes, hepatic portal vein, pancreas, aorta, oxygen rich, celiac artery, stomach, spleen, pancreas. All circulation is known as hepatic circulation. Now we talk about the coronary circulation. Coronary circulation means the heart has its own set of blood vessels that provide myocardium with the oxygen and nutrition necessary to pump blood throughout the body. Means heart also requires blood for its mechanical function, and we call it those arteries which are present on the heart, as you have seen in this figure, is known as coronary artery or coronary circulation. The left and right coronary arteries branch off from the aorta. They come from out of aorta and provide blood to the left and right side of the heart. The coronary sinus is a vein on posterior side of the heart that return deoxygenated blood from the myocardium to the vena cava. Coronary circulation is the circulation of the blood in the blood vessels of the heart muscles, myocardium. The vessels that deliver oxygen-rich blood to the myocardium are known as the coronary arteries. The vessels that remove the deoxygenated blood from the heart muscles are known as cardiac vein. The right aortic sinuses give rise to the right coronary artery, and the left aortic sinuses give rise to the left coronary artery. You have got these two main branches coming from the base of the aorta, the right and the left coronary artery. They have got various branches, which I am now going to talk about. Sulci, also on the heart, you have got groove. Sulci means there is a groove on the heart, means there is a ditch on the heart, there is a depth in the heart in which the vessels are lying. You got groove between the atrium and the ventricle, and you have a groove, got groove between the ventricles. Between the atrium and the ventricle, you have got a groove called the coronary sulcus. In anatomy, in refer to any groove, you will hear the word sulcus. In the brain, the grooves are called sulcus, sulci, plural, or sulcus, singular. And in the heart, the same thing applies. You have got grooves which are called sulci. The coronary sulcus runs between the atrium and the ventricle, and the coronary arteries run in this coronary sulcus. Between the ventricles, you have got an interventricular groove, an interventricular sulcus, This groove separates the right and left ventricle, and some major vessels run down this groove. Right coronary artery. Just following the right coronary artery around its course, it winds around along the coronary sulcus to the back of the heart, and it leaves off two main branches. You can see this branch on the right margin on the heart coming off the right coronary artery. This is called the right marginal branch, like the first branch. And as we follow the right coronary artery right to the back, you can see this groove running between the atrium and the ventricle, separating the atrium from the ventricle. It runs right around the heart, and then you can see this branch here. This is the posterior interventricular sulcus. The one showed you on the front is the anterior interventricular sulcus. The arteries that branches from the right coronary artery and runs down the posterior interventricular groove is the posterior interventricular artery, which is also known as the posterior descending artery. Now you have got two branches of the right coronary artery. You have got the right marginal artery, and you have got the posterior interventricular artery or the posterior descending artery. This is the right coronary artery you can see here in the coronary sulcus. Now this figure will verify what we have read. You can see there is a circumflex artery, right? This is the posterior side of the heart, back side of the heart. Right atrium, right ventricles, right? And you can see this more clearly. Anastomosis function of the vessel means they meet together. Anastomosis means marginal artery on the margin, you can see posterior interventricular artery and left atrial descending artery. Descending is coming down, left ventricle, then circumflex artery, left main coronary artery, and left atrium, and then pulmonary trunk, aorta, and superior vena cava. Now we will see the left coronary artery. The left coronary artery arises from the left aortic sinuses at the base of the aorta. Looking directly at the heart, you cannot actually see this branch. It's a hidden underneath the pulmonary trunk. Again, this artery has a few branches. The first branch, which you can see running down the anterior interventricular sulcus, is the anterior interventricular artery, otherwise known as the left anterior descending artery. There's the first branch of the left coronary artery. This thing here is the right atrial appendage. I'll just remove that so we can see a good look at the artery. This is the left coronary artery giving off the anterior interventricular artery as its first branch, and then it winds around all the way to the back, just like the right coronary artery. This branch, which winds all the way around, is known as the circumflex artery. This gives off a branch here. Like we have got this artery. Coming from the left coronary artery lying on the right margin of the heart, called the right margin branch or artery, we have got the artery on the left margin. It's the first marginal branch. This comes off the circumflex artery. The circumflex artery winds all the way to the back to the heart of base of the heart and extend down. You can see in this model the circumflex artery extends very far down. There is an anatomical variation between the people. Sometimes the posterior interventricular artery, which usually arises from the right coronary artery, it can arise as the circumflex artery of the left coronary artery. This is known as the coronary dominance. Someone whose posterior interventricular artery arises from the circumflex artery, they will be left dominant, whereas in the posterior circumflex artery, they will left dominant, where if the posterior interventricular artery arises from the right coronary artery, then they will be called right dominant. In the majority of the people, the posterior ventricular artery arises in the right side, but in some patient, the posterior interventricular artery arises from the circumflex artery. The posterior interventricular artery arises from the circumflex artery, in which case they are left dominant. In the case of this model, you can see both arteries run in equal length. This would be a case of co-dominant. There is an equal supply from the right and left coronary arteries to the posterior surface of the heart. Now we talk about the venous drainage. So the vein drainage of the heart is by several cardiac veins which drain into the coronary sinuses, which lies on the posterior aspect of the heart on inferior surface, this diagrammatic surface. You have got this coronary sinuses which lies between the left atrium and the left ventricle. It lies in the coronary sulcus between the left atrium and the left ventricle. The coronary sinuses drain blood back into the right side of the heart, just like all the other deoxygenated blood. It returns blood to the right atrium. This is the coronary sinuses here. It receives four tributaries. You have got the great cardiac vein, which runs the anterior interventricular sulcus and winds around to join the coronary sulcus at the back. That is the great cardiac vein. It runs down the anterior interventricular surface, winds around and the drain into the coronary sinuses. You have got this vein which runs down the posterior interventricular sulcus, and this is called the middle cardiac vein. This joins into the coronary sinuses. This one on the margin of the heart is the posterior cardiac vein. It needs the great cardiac vein to join the coronary heart sinuses. We just rotate to get around. You can see it lies on the left margin of the heart and it drains into the coronary sinuses. This is the posterior cardiac vein. And then on the right side of the heart, you have got this small cardiac vein. This thin little vein here, then running into the coronary sulcus, is called the small cardiac vein. That's run between the right atrium and the right ventricle. And you have seen and you have got this little branch which comes out of the small cardiac vein. This is the right marginal vein. This drain into the small cardiac vein, which drain into the coronary sinuses, which drain blood into the right atrium. You have got the coronary sinuses, which have four tributaries. You can got the greater cardiac vein running into the anterior interventricular sulcus. You have got the posterior cardiac vein, which runs on the left margin of the heart, which joins the great cardiac vein and joins into the coronary sinuses. And then you have got these other two veins which you need to know: the right marginal vein, which drain into the small cardiac vein, and you have got these veins here which are anterior veins. These veins, the anterior portion of the right ventricle, so that the venous drainage of the heart. This is all about a cardiovascular system we have just learned. And now we are going to start the alimentary system for the digestive system. system. So we were discussing about the alimentary system, which is a digestive system actually. The digestive system is made up of digestive tract. This consists of long tube of organs that run from the mouth to the anus and include the oesophagus, the stomach, the small intestine and large intestine, together with the liver, gallbladder and pancreas, which produce important secretion for the digestion that drain into the small intestine. The digestive tract is in adult is about 30 feet long. As I have mentioned you about the structure of the gastrointestinal system, we discuss individual component of whole gastrointestinal system, like oral cavity means mouth, salivary glands, oesophagus, stomach, small intestine, large intestine, liver, gallbladder, and pancreas. Gastrointestinal tract consists of the hollow muscular tube, starting from the oral cavity, means mouth, where food enters into the mouth, continuing through the pharynx, oesophagus, stomach, and intestine to the rectum and anus, where food is expelled. There are various accessory organs that assist the tract by secreting enzymes to help break down food into component nutrients. Thus, the salivary gland, liver, pancreas, and the gallbladder have important function in the digestive system. Food is propelled along the length of the GIT, gastrointestinal tract, by peristalsis, means movement like a snake of the muscular wall. Here is a figure. Go through it and read each and every part which is mentioned over here. The stomach is J-shaped organ with two opening, oesophagus and the duodenum, and four regions, the cardiac, fundus, body and pylorus. This is given in the figure. You can see the stomach is divided into four portions, pylori, body, fundus and cardiac. Four portions. This is green, yellow, blue and dark yellow. Orange is an oesophagus. This is a pyloric end, which starts the stomach end at the duodenum, and the joint is known as pyloric sphincter. And there is a cardiac sphincter where oesophagus join the stomach. Each region forms different functions. The fundus collect digestive gases. The body secretes pepsinogens and hydrochloric acid, HCl. And the pylori is responsible for mucus, gastrin, and pepsinogen secretion. The stomach has five major functions. What are the functions? Temporary food storage, control the rate at which food enters the duodenum, acid secretion, and antibacterial action, fluid section of the stomach contents, and preliminary digestion with pepsin, lipases, etc. Control the rate at which blood enters the duodenum. Acid secretion, that is HCl, from the parietal cells of the stomach, an antibacterial action. Fluidization of the stomach content is add the fluid into the stomach content in preliminary digestion with the pepsin, lipase, etc. enzymes. Now we talk about the pancreas. The pancreas consists of small, mainly of the exocrine gland that secretes enzyme to aid in the digestion of the food in the small intestine. The main enzyme produced are lipases, peptidases, and amylases for fat, protein, and carbohydrate, respectively. So the pancreas is playing a major role in the digestion of fats, protein, and carbohydrate through the enzymes of lipases, peptidases, and amylases. These are released into the duodenum via the duodenal ampulla, the same place that bile from the liver drain into. Pancreatic exocrine secretion is hormonally regulated, and the same hormone that encourages secretion, cholecystokinin, also encourages discharge of the gallbladder, store of the bile. In the same hormone have an effect on pancreas as well as gallbladder, and increase the secretion of the pancreas as well as from the gallbladder secrete the bile. As the bile is essential in emulsifying agent, it makes fat water soluble and gives the pancreatic enzyme lot of surface area to work on. Structurally, the pancreas has four sections: head, neck, body, and tail. And the tail stretch back to just in front of the streams. This is the figure of the pancreas. You can see there is a tail, there is a head of the pancreas, then there is a pancreatic duct in between, and this duct open into the small intestine at the duodenum. So this is the figure which will give you detailed information about the location of the pancreas, position of pancreas, anatomical position of pancreas at the duodenum. The small intestine. The small intestine is the site where most of the chemical and mechanical digestion is carried out, and where virtually all of the absorption of useful material is carried out. The whole of the small intestine is lined with an observative mucosal type with certain modifications. The whole of the small intestine is lined with an absorption mucus with certain modification for each section. The intestine also has a smooth muscles wall with two layers of muscles. Rhythmically, contraction force product of digestion through the intestine, peristalsis we call it. There are three main sections of the small intestine: duodenum, jejunum, ileum. The duodenum forms a C shape, as you have seen previous figure shapes around the head of the pancreas. Its main function is to increase, neutralize the acidic gastric content called the chyme, and to initiate further digestion. Bruner's gland is the submucous secretion in alkaline mucus which neutralize the chyme and protect the surface of the duodenum. The jejunum and then the ileum. The second portion is jejunum and third portion of the small intestine is ileum. The jejunum and the ileum are greatly coiled part of the small intestine, and together are about 4 to 6 meters long. The junction between the two sections is not well defined. The mucosa of this section is highly folded. The folds are called the lacy, increasing the surface area available for absorption. You can see here they have shown the duodenum, where the stomach meets to the small intestine, and then after duodenum, this intestine will have a second portion, which is known as duodenum, and the last is ileum. Then we talk about the large intestine. By the time digestive products reach the large intestine, almost all of the nutritionally useful products have been removed. The large intestine removes water from the remainder, passing semi-solid feces into the rectum to be expelled from the body through the anus. The mucus is arranged into tightly packed straight tubular glands, G glands, which consist of the cells specialized for water absorption and mucus secreting goblet cells to aid the passage of the feces. The large intestine also contains area of the lymphoid tissues. This can be found in the ileum too, called the pile patches, and they provide local immunological protection of the potential weak spots in the body defense. As the gut is teeming with the bacteria, reinforcement of the standard surface defenses seemingly only sensible. The micrograph above show a section of duodenum and clearly show the highly folded structure of the mucosa of a small intestine. The epithelial surface of the pellucid is further folded to form villi. These increase the surface area of the small intestine still further, and the surface of each villus is covered in a small microvilli to maximize surface area. The area available for absorption is vast. Each villi has its own blood supply. The vessels can be seen in the submucosa, and blood containing digestive product from the small intestine is taken to the liver via the hepatic portal system. The double muscle layer moves food through the intestine by peristalsis. This is the largest intestine you can see. It is started from the cecum. Then it will move upward, called the ascending colon, then transverse colon, then descending colon, then sigmoid colon, and it will open into rectum and anus. The basic structure of gastrointestinal tract is a muscular tube lined by a special layer of the cells called the epithelium. The content of the tube are considered external to the body and in continuous continuity with the outside world at the mouth and the anus. Although each section of tract has a specialized function, and the entire tract has a smaller basic structure with a regional variation. The GI tract contains four layers. The innermost layer is the mucosa. underneath this is the submucosa, followed by the muscular propera, and finally the outermost layer, the adventitia. The structure of these layers varies. In different regions of the digestive system, depending on their function. Here you can see the section of GI system, epithelium, lamina propria, from inside to outside. Adventitia is the top layer. Then muscular propera, then submucosa, then lamina propria, then epithelium. This is all about today. Then we'll take tomorrow the further portion. Thank you very much.
Okay.